I went to a garden party to reminisce with my old friends, a chance to share old memories and play our songs again. When I got to the garden party, they all knew my name, but no one recognized me. I didn't look the same, but it's alright now. I learned my lesson well. You see, you can't please everyone, so you got to please yourself.
All right, just about 6 minutes after 9 o'clock. Beautiful Tuesday morning. It's Earth Day, and Carolyn Baldwin is here to tell you what you can do to make the earth a little prettier with your lawn and garden questions and comments. And the phone number is your key, is your avenue, is your way to speak to Carolyn. The number is the WOCA Climate Control Source Hotline, 622-9622, 622-WOCA. The show is called You've Got a Garden. Good morning, Carolyn.
Good morning, Larry.
How's everything in your world?
Doing good. I got such a tall chair here today. Am I close enough?
Oh, is this the first time you... Yeah. This the first time you've been here?
Since with the new chairs. Because before I was hiding underneath the desk with my chin sitting on top.
Yeah, they look nice, don't they?
Yeah, they are. They're sharp.
Get some getting used to, I guess.
Yeah.
You come in here.
It feels good. You know, a little taller, a little brighter. Hey, the sun is shining. It's warm out.
It's wonderful.
I'm much happier than I had been for the last couple of days. The weatherman kept lying to me. And I hate to be lied to like that. I feel so, abused when they tell me in the morning the sun's going to come out and I wear shorts.
Yes,
and ready for
that
it.
Did happen.
I'm cold.
And that did happen.
I had a
happen.
Jacket on all the way past lunch yesterday. And so that wasn't happy. And Sunday, the sun was supposed to come out.
Exactly.
I had on jeans and a long sleeve shirt and a jacket all day long. I was cold. I know if we had those same temperatures in January, we'd be going, it's pretty nice out.
Yeah, right. Good point.
But it's supposed to be spring, so it's supposed to be warm.
I had the same thought, though, that the weatherman was betraying us.
Just abusing us with his lies.
But in truth, I mean, years ago when we were kids, the weatherman got it wrong a lot more often. Now they get it right most of the time.
They do, but still, what better job can you have to be wrong 50% of the time and still get paid good money? Yeah.
Well, talk show host is one of them.
You
can be wrong a lot of times.
Well, but as a host, you're just relating the other people's information.
Well, I didn't mean me. I didn't necessarily mean me.
Of course, like with me, I can be wrong, and everybody just pee, and they just point and laugh.
And you got the phones lit up. Let's take some of these calls. Good morning. Thank you for calling. You're on the air with Carol Ann. I think. Are you there?
Good morning.
Did I do something wrong here? You there? All right, let me try it again. Sometimes I do something wrong. See? But I still get paid.
That's
right, Joe?
There you go.
Joe still pays me. I do things wrong. Good morning. You're on the air.
Good morning. I think that was me. I didn't hear anything, so I just called back.
Oh, okay. Okay.
Okay. I have a couple questions.
Sure.
First is, I have yellow leaves on a gardenia plant.
Okay.
They're just turning just mostly yellow on the leaves. Should I try to correct that or just let it go?
It's a good chance it's just normal. I mean, we've had some strange fluctuating temperatures. They do have, because they are evergreen, they do drop leaves off and on throughout the growing season. Have you fertilized them yet this year?
I'm an organic gardener.
Okay.
So I pretty much just use compost and horse manure. And I did put compost and horse manure down, but that was all.
Right.
And mulch.
And some mulch. Make sure it's not too heavy around them. When you're using the compost and horse manure, if you're putting a couple of inches or so on there once a year or something, I know after a while it does break down and the level goes back down. But if you get too much mulch, it might get a little deep around them. But that is kind of normal that they do have some yellow leaves off and on throughout the season, and it can be quite a few on the plant. So long as you're not seeing spots or insect, I wouldn't really think too much about it. You could try a soil acidifier a little bit to that, which sulfur is one. I'm not sure what the other item is that there actually is, one that just acidifies the soil. It's not really a nutritional it changes the pH so that the plant can actually take up the nutrition a little easier.
Okay. Well, I won't do anything then unless it really looks something noticeable, I guess.
Right, right. If you've got one of those little pH meters or something like that, you might just check that and just see whether where you're running. They have, they have something that you can just poke in the ground. And they're somewhat accurate, especially if you keep judging it by what you make one a baseline of what you know, and going by that, and you get a twice a year or something like that that you can check and see.
Okay, and the second question is, I got some hydrangeas bought for my mom.
Okay.
And she won't call, so I'm calling for
okay.
I have to do the work, but sure. I told her I'll find out where to put them. They're nice, big, from a florist shop.
Okay.
So, she has oak trees.
Uh-huh.
Because the lady at the florist shop told me to put them, they needed to be in the partial shade, not to put them out in the full sun.
Right, right. They like filtered light. So under a canopy works well. Are they blue or are they pink?
Pink.
Okay, then if she wants them to stay pink, she's going to have to watch the alkalinity, because hydrangeas, some are bred to be pink, but with some of the hydrangeas, you can actually change them pink to blue on the pH. If you want pink, you need to keep the pH a little bit on the alkaline side. So she may want to put a little bit of lime in with them. When you put it down, get them planted and maybe, work a little bit of lime, a couple, maybe a cup or two into the soil before you plant it. And then that would keep that pH a little bit higher, which would help to keep that pink color. Now, were these a florist hydrangea or were they a garden hydrangea?
Well, the lady at the florist shop told me that we could put them in the ground.
Okay.
And she said, yes, they might even change colors. But she said, do not put them out in full sun.
No.
And I said, well, what about the big oak tree? She says, that would be fine.
Right, right. That's fine. The florist ones, putting them in now, if they're going to make it, because sometimes the florist ones really just are not bred to be as hardy as, say, the landscape varieties. But if... It could be how she's getting them. If it's the one that's going to change, it's probably going to be fine out there. But yes, under the oak trees, will be happy. If she would like it to go blue, you go with the soil acidifier. Sulfur or the something like that.
So, but if she just sticks it in the ground and doesn't care what color, just stick it in there and see what happens.
Just put it in the ground and see what happens. Right.
She's not particular about it. Okay.
There you go.
And fertilizer, should she put something in the hole when they're digging the hole? Should they put something?
Not necessarily. I mean, you could mix some compost in with it just to make sure that soil can hold a little bit of moisture. That'll fertilize it for a while. And I usually try not to fertilize anything for at least about 6 weeks after they've been put in the ground, because you're watering it so frequently that you're just sort of washing that fertilizer away.
And it does need to be watered, is it almost every day in the beginning, for the first week?
It is. Yeah, and it's just a watering can's worth. It's not a whole lot. And if this is a small one, you might even be talking just about, a pitcher full of water. Uh-huh. To, go out there and put it on there around that root ball each morning, and then after like the first week, drop that down, to like every other day, and then you might even the third week drop it to half the amount of water every other day, until you get it down to after about 6 weeks, you're down to pretty much what nature does. If we're a little on the dry side, a little supplemental water every 10 days, 2 weeks or so. Works,
but it's important for that first week especially, isn't it?
Yes.
To be watered every day?
Yes. Sure is. And like, yeah. I said, if it was just a small pot, about a pitcher, which is about 2 quarts, little half gallon pitcher's generally going to be enough.
Okay. All right, great. That'll do it. Appreciate it. Thank you.
Oh, you're welcome. You're welcome. Yeah, when you a lot of times when, and of course we did just have Easter, so a lot of gifts were bought, and just like people buy the kids bunnies and chicks and realize that was a big mistake. Sometimes we buy florist plants or we buy different ones, and they're not really designed to go in the landscape. There's these little florist azaleas. Now we grow azaleas wonderfully here in, you know, in our climate, and these look just like the same ones, but they're kind of frail. They were either grown very quickly, forced to put on a lot of bloom at the wrong time, or set up that it bloomed again, and that just the stems and the root zones aren't real tough. So with some of that, you may grow it a little longer in the pot or put it into a larger pot and try to grow it, you know, grow it in the outdoor conditions, and just see whether or not you can get it, you know, a little sturdier, a little hardier, to where it's going to acclimate into your landscape. With the hydrangeas, was a good question of finding out where they need to grow. Most of our azaleas, not all, but most of our azaleas are shade-loving plants. Hydrangea, the same thing. They like a filtered sun. They like, you know, a high canopy allows plenty of light to come through, but not direct sunlight to burn the leaves and the flowers on them. And trying to think what else they had, the Easter lilies and things like that. Once those Easter lilies and the Asiatic lilies bloom, they're done for this year. You don't need to throw them away, but you just realize the top of that plant is eventually going to die down. It's going to vanish for a while. Next year, it'll come back up. So you can either, like my daughter did, she just put hers last year into another pot, set the pot aside, and lo and behold, about 2 months ago, the plant's coming up. It has added another piece of plant to it, so it has multiplied itself, and it's beginning to put on flowers. So she'll have it, you know, for this. And it's putting on the flowers when it's supposed to be.
Huh.
You know, that now the Easter lilies do usually bloom this time of year. That's just kind of, that's normal for them. The Asiatic lilies, they usually bloom a little closer to the
summer. They're pretty, but they always remind me of death.
Yeah.
Because of the cartoons. Because in the cartoons, they always gave a lily to, like, Bugs Bunny when he died.
Right.
He always died, remember?
Yes. Every cartoon. Somebody was trying to off him.
All right, we have a phone call. Good morning. You're on the air with Carol Ann.
Yeah, good morning. I want to ask a question. How can I get my orange trees to bloom? I mean, sometimes they bloom some years and some they don't. I mean, I don't know what I'm doing wrong.
Are you pruning them any?
No, I'm not pruning them, but I mean, I don't know. I mean, maybe they're not in the sun. They're growing good. The trees are growing real good.
Okay. What you might try, and this is one of those little weird unorthodoxed, I don't know if you can prove it or disprove it kind of thing, but I've seen it work, is this time of year, it's a little late to do it because most all your citrus trees have already bloomed. They've set fruit. But in, say, the fall, or very early spring, maybe January or early February, well, I'd say fall, go back to fall, is you take a belt, a hose, a chain, something like that, and you beat the trunk.
Really?
And for some reason, I don't know if it thinks it's being damaged or, you know, hacked on, getting ready to be chopped down, whatever it really is, it seems to throw them into a time that they will begin to bloom.
Ray, you gotta go beat your tree.
Yeah, and that's, I've seen it work. It's strange. I don't know exactly why, except for that kind of thing. But what, you know, because what does anything on this earth want to do but reproduce itself? And so if it thinks it's being threatened that it's going to die, it's going to attempt to reproduce itself.
Well, that's like, you know, that sounds crazy, but I saw a man doing that to a fruit tree and all, and he was actually talking to the tree and was threatening it. And I mean, but maybe the trees can hear us and know what we're thinking. That's something to do, you know, with the Lord. But anyway, that was I've seen a man do that before.
Yeah,
he was telling the trees gonna get rid of it.
Beating it with a belt or a hose or a piece of chain, something like that, and say, you know, you better bloom or out you come.
Wow.
I can replace you with a tree that will fruit, and it's a practice I heard of from somebody from like the islands, where that's you know, it was customary practice that if the tree didn't fruit, wasn't bearing after when it should have been, it gets a good beating. If it doesn't bloom the next year, out it goes.
Yeah, well, it does make sense. Okay, well, thank you.
You're welcome. I know it's one of those strange things. But I saw it when we had the citrus trees at the county extension office. We had a navel orange and a grapefruit tree. They were both in the garden, opposite ends. Both treated pretty much the same. The lighting and such was a little different between them. But the grapefruit tree bloomed, fruited like crazy, and you look down there at that navel orange and not one. And this was, they were planted at the same time, they were the same age trees, same size, like I said, the same amount of fertilizer, etc. And so finally, again, that whole thing, somebody says, well, beat on it. And we did, and the next year that tree flowered and set about 3 dozen fruit. The year after that, it was much a higher amount. So it was just something that it needed to trigger. I don't know.
Somebody must be beating on my orange tree. It produces lots of oranges.
And somebody's just kicking it every time. it's hard to, it's hard to say why it works, but it seems,
That is fascinating.
It's cheap and it's worth a try. And if you're embarrassed to do it early in the morning or late at night, and nobody will see you.
And you yell,
at it. You just didn't tell it that it needs to bloom
and
fruit.
You don't have any
otherwise,
anger going?
Otherwise, it's going.
So your neighbors don't think you're nuts. You sing a happy song.
Yeah, you
don't want to be out there.
If you're happy and you know it, grow some fruit.
That was nice. That was good.
So I know it's another one of those strange little things, like if people like okra. Not everybody likes okra, but planting okra, the seed is very, very hard. And sometimes you have these little tricks. Some people say soak them overnight in hot water. Eventually that hot water cools, so you're only soaking them for 30 minutes in hot water. The rest is just finishing softening. Or what you can take is drop one okra seed or two in the cell of an ice cube tray. So your ice cube tray makes, two dozen ice cubes.
Whatever,
so you're dropping your seed, and you fill that with very hot water and then throw it in the freezer. And then once those ice cubes are frozen with the little seed in it, you go out at night and plant your okra. And the reason you go out at night to plant the okra is you don't want your neighbors to think you've gone crazy planting ice cubes in your garden. But
your neighbors are really going to think you're crazy with all these suggestions today.
These little weird ones. But the ice cube thing, I think, actually works better than just soaking them. So if you have some of those hard to germinate seeds like okra, nasturtium, some of those really hard seeds. What I think the freezing does is just it allows that moisture to stay with the seed, so that when you do put it, whether it's in a pot or out in the garden, it holds that moisture right there beside that seed for that little while. But the hot water initially helped to soften the outer coating of it to speed and aid germination. Just one of those.
By the way, this Friday is Arbor Day.
It's
the day we think about our trees.
Supposed to plant trees.
Well, today's Earth Day.
Yeah, today's Earth Day. But you know what? It should be every day. Should be Earth Day. You just be a good steward of the planet. You know, yell at people who throw trash out the windows.
If you could see this parking lot in the morning.
Oh, I have, and it's hard.
It's unbelievable.
You kind of wonder. Well, and where I live, I am across the street from a convenience store, and the amount of trash
it's unbelievable
that gets thrown out of windows or blows out of the back of pickup trucks.
Blowing out is a different thing, though.
Yeah, but even then, don't put the trash in the back of your truck.
Right, right. But so many people just do it intentionally.
Right. Oh, I know. I know.
Diapers.
Yes. That's
how many times you see in this parking lot
a soiled diaper there's a trash bin.
Unbelievable.
There's a trash bin.
Yeah.
There's no reason. I carry a garbage can in my car, a little wastebasket that I can put all my trash in there. There's no reason to throw trash.
That's what I need, a trash can in my car.
You must empty it also every so often. Every so often, you take the little bag out and throw it away. But no, every day should be Earth Day to, you know, and I think to all of our listeners, it basically is. I think we all have a love of nature, what we have here locally with our springs, with our national forest, the Gulf and the Atlantic, both, all of our rivers. We have a special reason because of where we're at to just be year-long good stewards of the planet, of our resources. And it's just, I find it amazing in the field I work in, talking with people daily about fertilizers, and they wonder, I always wonder, why can't we just educate people? And every time I talk to somebody and they're going, well, why not? Why did they take this out? Why do we? I've always followed this kind of plan, and it's kind of going, well, that might have worked well where you lived because your soils were different than where we're at now. Why can't I use this liquid fertilizer? And it's, well, because it goes through our soils much more quickly, and just different things where people are ready to just, oh, I put fertilizer on 3 weeks ago, I'm ready to put more on. And it's like, no, please stop. Stop. Look at what you're doing before you're not doing your yard any good. You're not doing your landscape any benefit by overusing the fertilizers, which we're finding out they're still the talk on, preserving our lakes, rivers, streams, and springs, and especially the springs. They keep talking about some of them being so low flow, and then the nitrates in the other ones is watching, how much, what are you putting on the ground? And how much of it and when. Also trying to convince people that you don't put your fertilizer or your pest control or your herbicides down when a rain event is planned. Your best bet is to put that down, and if you have irrigation, turn it on for the 10-15 minutes it takes to put a quarter of an inch of water down, to which is what's recommended on those products, to get it activated and into the soil, or stand out there with your hose and do it the way that you have to. Don't wait for the rain, because we never know. We can get a quarter of an inch of rain, or we can get 4 inches all at one, in one fell swoop. And if you put your fertilizer down and we get 4 inches, half of it's either at your neighbor's, and he's maybe mighty happy because he didn't fertilize. He saw you put it down and knew it was going to rain. So he's going to wait and see how much your fertilizer will get his. Right. And the other half's down the storm sewer on its way to our lakes, rivers, and streams springs. Right. So be a good steward every day.
I think so.
Yeah.
I think so.
That's your best way.
See, and the fine line that you walk when you try to have that discussion on the air is you risk people calling you a tree hugger or a nutcase, and right. I always think, well, since when? I mean, since when is being a good steward of your backyard or your lawn?
Being a good steward is not the same thing as being a tree hugger. I'm for advancement. Proper development and such like that, can benefit the community just as well. But also, when you're replanting, but being the proper steward in your own area, what was it? Oh, it was at a dinner the other night with Master Gardeners, and someone had related a call that they had received at the extension office at the Master Gardener Clinic, and this lady had called in and she wanted to take care of some weeds, but she really was somebody who liked to stay chemical free, so she was wondering whether or not she could use vinegar or diesel fuel to take care of the weeds out in the pasture, which to her going, you know, organic was diesel fuel.
Well, made out of peanuts, isn't it?
Well, not really.
we got to take a little break. Fox News is coming up, and we'll be right back. Remember, Carolyn's show is brought to you by...
Black Cow Cow Manure, the mature manure.
All right. We will take a little break and be right back. Your questions are invited, by the way. Your comments, the number is the WOCA Climate Control Source Hotline, 622-WOCA.
Fox News Radio, I'm Lillian Wu, Washington, signaling support for Ukraine with a visit from the Vice President.
No nation has the right to simply grab land from another nation.
Vice President Joe Biden speaking in Kiev, also calling on Russia to work toward reducing tensions in the region. President Obama seeing firsthand today the devastation from last month's mudslide near Seattle that killed at least 41 people, and the number of confirmed dead in the ferry sinking off South Korea topping 100, but nearly 200 are still missing.
Better weather today has allowed divers to spend more time within the sunken ferry, and they have been able to retrieve a number of bodies. The South Korean authorities have also deployed an underwater robot to aid in the search. Cranes are also on standby to eventually raise the vessel.
Fox's David Piper, Fox News. We report, you decide.
The world is going crazy. There's the potential zombie-geddon, the meteorite apocalypse, and dolphins are becoming too smart for their own good. Prepare your getaway car now. Stock up on Napa synthetic oil for just $3.49 a quart. $3.49. There's hope for us all. Conquer the job with Napa know-how. At participating Napa Auto Parts stores, sale price does not include applicable state local taxes or recycling fees. Offer expires 4/30/14.
And now, another golf confessional brought to you by Golfsmith. Recently, a man told us he'd finally learned to deal with his anthropophobia, an overwhelming fear of other people. How? He went to Golfsmith and got the Nike VRS Covert 2.0 driver with its high-speed cavity back design. Now he hits the ball so far, he doesn't have to be around anyone on the course. You don't need a psychological disorder to get the Nike VRS Covert 2.0 driver. You just need to go to Golfsmith.
Hi, I'm Yvette, and I'm here to tell you a few things about ABC Frederick's Appliance. They sell not only new, but used guaranteed appliances. When you call ABC Frederick's Appliance, they will provide service on what they sell and any appliances that you own. ABC Frederick's Appliance is located in Bellevue, right over the railroad tracks. Call 352-629-5181. That's 352-629-5181. That's 352-629-5181. ABC Frederick's Appliance.
Black Cow composted cow manure is a terrific organic soil amendment. We start with cow manure from dairy farms and then compost it a full 90 days. The result is an all-natural, dark, rich soil amendment that's great for everything you grow. Flowers, vegetables, shrubs, trees, and lawns too. Look for Black Cow in the bright yellow and black bag at your favorite nursery or garden center.
Black Cow, the mature manure. Black Cow.
Hi, Robin. You look tired.
I am. I've been running all over town.
Why? Why not drive?
I need to get this stupid document notarized.
Well, that's easy. You need personal service.
Duh. That's what I've been looking for.
You need to go see Mark at the Personal Service Center. He can notarize that for you, make copies, fax it wherever, or send it out in the mail. Heck, he can even scan it and email it for you.
Really? Where is he at?
2375 Northeast 25th Avenue, on the corner of Northeast 25th Avenue and 24th Street. You can call him at 789-6683.
Personal Service Center. Thanks, Larry.
Hi, this is Carol Ann Baldwin. I quit fertilizing flowers and vegetables the old-fashioned way. Now I use Dynamite Premium Plant Food. With its easy, earth-friendly, patented coating, there's no risk of over-fertilizing. Dynamite Complete Plant Food releases nutrients for 7 months, so there are no highs or lows during the growing season. Dynamite Premium Plant Food contains complete nutrition, including micronutrients like copper, magnesium, iron, and zinc. This gives my plants explosions of blooms for both veggies and flowers. When I use Dynamite Premium Plant Food, I only have to use it once every 7 months, and don't worry about the nutrients washing out with heavy rains or irrigation. To learn more about the Dynamite family of products, go to dynamiteplantfood.com. Dynamite Premium Plant Food is so easy to use that you'll spend less time working in your garden and more time enjoying it.
Veterans are the foundation upon which our freedom is built. Listen to The Source, WOCA, each Thursday at 9 a.m. to Veterans News with Hank Whittier from Vets Helping Vets. You'll hear tributes, information on veterans' issues, and stories that will make you laugh, cry, and feel proud. Veterans News always focuses on the military, past and present, and on our first responders. Veterans News is brought to you each week by Palm Chevrolet, where supporting the community is the Palm Chevy way, and by Bob Wine's Camellia Gardens and Nursery, keeping you blooming since 1952.
All right, 25 minutes before 10 o'clock, let's return to Carol Ann Baldwin, and You've Got a Garden. And if you've got a question for Carol Ann or just something you want to comment on, the number is the WOCA Climate Control Source Hotline, 622-9622. By the way, 66 beautiful degrees. Look at this beautiful day,
it's
huh?
It's gorgeous.
Nice day.
This is the days that...
This should have been Easter.
This should have been Easter, exactly.
This looks like Easter.
This looks better like Easter.
We need to reschedule Easter.
Would have been a much nicer day. Thinking, you know, with Earth Day and Arbor Day and all of those kind of things. Well, this is called a Saturday. Sorry.
We get one 52 times a year, right?
Yeah, we do. And this one only comes once a year, Saturday, May the 10th. It's the Master Gardener's 2014 Spring Plant Sale. From 8 a.m. till noon, again, it's Saturday the 10th, and they will be having pollinator plants, butterfly plants, hummingbird plants, herbs and perennials, fruit trees, ornamentals, shade trees, and shrubs, and all the stuff that they're growing is, you know, good quality. They take a great pride in growing a nice product, and it does, the proceeds all go to help support some of the educational programs that they put on throughout the year, because all of those do take money, and it's, you know, as Master Gardeners, even though we're a volunteer organization through University of Florida Extension, et cetera, it still takes finances that, you know, are not provided by the state or the county. Mm-hmm. But and anything that you're looking for, it is cash or check only. They do not have, I don't know why they haven't come up with a credit card swipe yet, but maybe one day. You know, those things are only about $100 that you can
on your phone,
kind of thing. But they'll also have soil testing kits available, the gardening publications from the university. Master Gardeners will be there to answer questions. The South Oaks 4-H Club will be there to offer plant toting. They help you get your plants back to your car. The kids plant toting.
I like that.
Hire a kid is usually what they have. It is, you know, rent a kid. You know, they work for tips, and it helps to cover some of their summer camp things with 4-H and other projects that they themselves are working on. Teaches them good responsibility. So that's a bunch of, you know, good bunch of kids. So that's something you can do on May the 10th. And, of course, I can't see my – we don't have a calendar hung up in here. But I will find mine in a very big hurry.
You have an electronic calendar.
Yeah, my electronic calendar. I believe it is May the 8th. Is the 100th anniversary of the founding of Cooperative Extension, of the Extension
Service. They're having a party?
It's a 100th anniversary. I believe there are several different things going on throughout the nation, probably within different ag centers around, you know, because it's 100 years that County Extension, and County Extension was formed in order to be an extension of the land grant colleges. Right. You know, that those universities were a grant from the federal government to the states in order to make public education or higher education affordable to the public.
Have you ever, and this is really going to throw you a curve, and I don't mean to, but maybe something will pop in mind. Have you ever heard of a community that absolutely 100% got on board a decision to change, like, what fertilizer they use or something for the better, and could literally measure the difference in the lakes and the waterways? And
I don't know if they can measure it or not, but we know Hillsborough and I believe it's Pinellas County have very, very strict regulation. But knowing some people who live over in those areas actually says it backfires, because people will go, their way of going around the law is to over-fertilize before their time of their, you know, June the 1st in those counties, you will not buy a fertilizer that has nitrogen in it, or, you know, I believe at all, between June 1st and September 1st. That fertilizer, it's taken off the market. They will not allow you to buy it. So what people will do is come in, they fertilized in February, and at the end of May, they will go out and they will buy fertilizer and they will put it down right before the moratorium goes on. And then as soon as it comes back, they're dumping more on.
So my question would be, if somebody were to do that, that means they would know or at least believe that more nitrogen would help their lawn or their garden.
They believe so, but it's not necessarily.
But you don't believe it, and the experts can
tell you that more is not better. You know, with anything we know, more medicine's not better. More, you know, more sugar in the cake batter does not make a better cake.
Oh, I think it does.
No, it makes it too sweet.
Teasing. All right, here we go. We got another phone call. Good morning. You're on the air.
Yes, good morning, everybody.
Hey, morning.
You.
See, we had kind of a crummy weather weekend, Easter, Friday, Saturday, Sunday, so I put it in the mood to clean my shed out, which I did. And way in the back and the bottom, I found grass seed, and I know that grass seed's been in there at least 5 years, if not more.
Wow.
Is it any good yet?
Probably not.
Probably not, no.
Because in your shed it got so hot.
Yeah,
and the moisture and things. I think most of the seeds, does it still have a date on it?
No, well, what I did is I poured the seed into a Ziploc.
Okay.
And then I marked it, you know, grass seed, and then I put it away and forgot about it, you know. So I have no idea what the deal on that is.
No, it's probably not any good, but you know what? It wouldn't hurt anything just to spread it out on the yard. It's not going to damage anything. And if a little bit of it was still good, it would, you know, it would come up.
Yeah, normally speaking, what is the life expectancy of a grass seed normally?
Grass seed, I believe, without testing, because I believe they actually, for Florida, especially because of our humidity, if it were kept in a more ideal location, say, in, you know, where it had air conditioning, where your temperatures don't fluctuate that badly, you're talking maybe 2 years. I think they actually relabel that if they retest it, they will continue to add a year to it. But I think without running any tests or anything, I would say you could probably keep it for 2 years and figure that it would still germinate with a pretty high germination rate. After that, your rate's going to begin to drop, I think, significantly.
Would it make any sense
to,
if you have a leftover seat?
To... Oh, you dropped off, Hugh. Hugh, we lost you.
We did.
My computer says you're still there, but we don't hear you. He's gone.
He hit the mute button.
It sounded like it, didn't it?
Yeah.
It sounded like he did. Yeah, I don't know. We can't hear you, Hugh. It says he's still... Oh, it says it ended, so
okay.
I guess he disconnected. He'll probably call back.
Right. I think what he might have been getting ready to ask, does it make any sense to save that seed? Okay, it's probably him back.
It might be Hugh back. Good morning, you're on the air.
Yeah, I'm sorry, okay. I don't know what happened. Maybe a plane flew overhead or something. I was going to ask, like, if you had extra seed, if you would freeze it, would that make any sense?
No, I wouldn't freeze it, but if it's... you know, if you can put it in like the bottom drawer of the fridge,
okay,
kind of thing, that, you know, or even like I said, if you're going to use it the next spring, or you believe, you know, or you would use that one first, and if you needed more, you would buy more. I would just, even if you kept it in the house, just where it's a little cooler, you know, as compared to outside in the shed.
Yeah, and then keep the humidity away from it too. If you can. Yeah. Okay, very good. I'll do that, and thank you very much.
Oh, you're welcome. You're welcome. Yeah, saving some of that seed. So, you know, it may last a couple of years, but in the shed, it does have a tendency to, you know, to get a little too hot, that humidity, because our, you know, when our humidity gets up there to, you know, 80% on some of those summer days, that's a lot of moisture that begins to degrade that seed. That's why... you know, even applying pesticides and fertilizers when it's that hot, it's too quick. the humidity and the moisture and things like that, and that heat, it's just too fast to make things work.
So, you know, he reminded me of two things I found in my shed.
What'd you find in your shed?
One was a bag of the fire ant killer. I wonder if that would still work. That's probably been 4 or 5 years old.
That should still be good.
And the other one was the Roundup. I found a gallon of Roundup.
Now, on something like that, on liquid products, what can happen is they'll crystallize.
Oh, really?
Inside. Yeah, because even though you cap it off good, a little bit is evaporating from that. So that could crystallize. Now, the dry stuff is usually, so long as it's been closed up well, that should still be good for a couple of years.
Okay.
Even the Roundup for a little while, but as you shake it, you know, shake up the Roundup, actually listen to it and open it up, take a look and see. Yeah, can you hear crystals? Because it is a salt. It will begin to crystallize. If it's doing that, follow directions on how to dispose of it. It's probably going to be something you're going to go have hazardous waste.
Oh, really?
You know, which they have the collections occasionally.
And you have another phone call. Good morning. You're on the air with Carol Ann.
Hi, Carol Ann.
Hey.
I called in last week about the mysterious little yellow flower that pops up in my yard.
Yes.
And they are still popping up. Have you had any luck?
The only thing I was thinking of, because I mentioned it to Larry, and I said, I can't remember who that was. I was thinking of Indian pipes. Do you know what Indian pipes are?
No.
But the ones, when I looked them up, I didn't see any yellow ones. They actually come up and they turn, as anybody can tell, see me looking, turn over. And if you were to picture it, if you plucked it out of the ground and turned it up, you might think it looked like a small tobacco pipe.
Oh.
And I'm not sure if that's was what you had, because they're I'd have to look it up again of what the description of the plant itself is on what it's, whether or not it's actually a fungus. If I had a picture of what you had of your little flower, it'd sure make it easier.
Yeah, maybe I should bring one into the Ag Center.
You can do that, or if you want to bring one by the radio station, you know, here by the Paddock Mall. Oh, you're closer to the Ag Center? Okay. Yeah, they may be able to identify it for you, because, the Indian pipes is what I was thinking, but then I'm saying, you know what, that's probably not what it is, because these were all white ones, white or pink.
This looks like a lily.
Okay.
Opens up, it's got the petals, you know.
Okay.
I dug down underneath, and it doesn't seem to have any kind of roots. And evidently, as soon as it pops up, it's too heavy to hold itself up, and it falls down.
And it tips over.
Yeah.
Huh.
It's a mystery plant.
Yeah, I'll keep looking, but like you said, if you can bring one by the Ag Center.
Yeah.
And you're saying it's growing in shade, right?
Yes. Yes.
I just
thought maybe a listener has experienced the same thing.
Right.
Might call in.
Yeah. If anybody's seen one, because is it dark shade? Is it?
It's a bright mustard yellow. Beautiful.
Mustard yellow, and you say looks like a lily.
Yes.
Well, it might be one. It may be a little wild lily.
Why doesn't it have a stem or any leaves? That's what's befuddling.
Okay, but you do see them standing up? I mean, if you go out in the morning?
No, when I see them, they've already fallen over.
And there's no, sure it's not just the flower off of something that's vining that's way up in the top of the trees?
I don't think so.
Because, like, I have, you can't see the plant, when it was planted, I have no idea where the actual plant is. I have no idea. But I have yellow Alamanda blossoms that'll fall on the Alamanda vine, fall on the ground on a regular basis, but I have no idea where the vine is.
Yeah.
Yeah, and you'll find these flowers just littering the ground, and you're not sure. And same thing with, like, the little yellow jessamine. Again, that, you know, where the vine is. I could probably find that one. But it's because it's gotten so high up in the trees, you're just finding the flowers on the ground, you know, when they drop.
Well, that's an idea.
That's, you know, it's okay. It's a possibility.
Thank you so much.
You're welcome.
Bye.
Bye-bye.
All right, another phone call, Carolyn. Good morning. You're on the air with Carolyn.
Good morning, Carolyn.
Morning.
I keep getting ready to go out there and do battle with the weeds. And I do have the little yellow flowers in my front lawn on the one side, but they seem to be associated with that dollar weed plant.
Dollar weed or the oxalis?
Excuse me?
It might be the oxalis, a yellow oxalis.
Well, I don't know, but they're small, yellow
little
flowers in full sunlight, and there's no trees around. I definitely believe that if you have a commercial service coming around, these people just, I think, take, you know, the weeds or whatever get caught up in their undercarriage or by the blade and the deck.
Right.
And they just seem to be spreading them around. I caved in and had somebody do my lawn last year. And boy, I have weeds like you wouldn't believe now.
Yeah. So, and that can be an issue. And I've said you can ask them that before they bring that mower onto your property is to blow it off or rinse it off in order to get rid of that residue. It can also be if your neighbor has weeds and when they mow, they're blowing all that weed seed up into the air as well, and they just blow across, and wherever they land, they take root.
Well, this guy's mower, boy, it goes at full RPM. And
100 miles an hour, yeah.
Yeah, and the blades are, you know, make such a horrendous noise. I mean, you know, I guess you could slow it down a little, but, you know, they're there to do a lawn and get out as soon
right.
as they can, go to the next one.
That's sure.
The thing. I mean, I can't fault them for that.
No.
The more lawns they do, the more money they make.
Right, right. And it's not the speed of their mowing, so long as their blades are sharp. That's all that matters, and that they're not running over your shrubbery and jumping the curb and taking out the flower bed.
There's no problem there. It's just that I honestly believe that, you know, they could mow a subdivision with common ground.
Right.
And nobody worries about them. And then next thing you know, they're on your lawn. So they picked up the weeds from the common grounds and they're spreading them around on your grass.
It is quite possible, especially if they do several yards in a row. I know when my mother was alive and she lived in an adult community, everybody used the guy in the park who mowed. I mean, he came through. He was the trashman. He was the mow man. Yeah. He was and I mean, he was paid through park, the what you,
right.
your services.
Those
and they did. They just sort of, right, through your, so, and yeah, he would run, you know, you'd run that front strip right along the curb through all of the yards that adjoined each other and front to back, the easement strip, and then, you know, he'd go around, you know, the edge or around, but yeah, it's something that spreads the, you know, if the weed was in one spot, it's now all over the place. But
right. Well, anyway, I thought I heard your previous call talking about these little yellow flowers, and I'm standing in the window looking at them right now.
Look at, well, hers is one in the shade that looks like the little flower looks like a lily, so I'm not, not real sure what she's got.
All I can tell you is standing here looking at them. They're little yellow flowers, and they're in the grass, and there's no trees around, and it's full sunshine.
Right, right. No, there's
photographs would help here, huh?
Yeah, oh, yeah.
If these were the ones that I'm thinking of, they don't seem to go far, you know, down as far as the roots go. You can almost rake them up.
Oh, okay. Yeah, well, with hers, it didn't even have a stem, so that's what I'm thinking. It probably
got away from roots.
Yeah, I'm thinking that one kind of got away from a vine that's up higher that you can't see for hers. Yeah.
Sounds like that flower that floats on the water. It's a lily pad flower or something?
Yeah, but those have a stem.
Yeah. Oh, do they?
Yeah.
And they have water.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, anyway, that's... my problem with a little yellow flower.
Yeah.
I am not into all the names and everything.
No, no. If it's a weed in the yard, you treat the weed. That's all that matters. Are you trying to grow it or trying to kill it?
I almost forgot.
Yeah.
I have a lot of these shilling plants.
Okay.
I trim them and, just to keep them from growing crazy.
Right.
And they're pretty old now. Can you cut these back and expect new growth, or should eventually start thinking about replacing them?
If they've been in for a while and you've kept them shaped and they're starting to get a little thin inside, you might be thinking about replacing them. If they're starting to get real woody, real thick stems at the bottom, I'm not sure if they would really come back as full as you'd like them to by just pruning, just trying to cut them back further than usual.
Well, I keep cutting them and and trimming them.
Right.
But they still seem to they be getting bigger, so all I thought was to go in there and whack off a third.
You could bring them back
into shape.
You know what? You can try it, and if it doesn't look like it's filling, the only thing you did was you gave them a little too much of a haircut. Maybe you might not go a third. How high are they? About 3 feet or bigger?
Oh, they're about. The big ones are around 4 foot high.
About 4 foot. You might take a good 6 inches off of them, and then make sure that when you prune them, are yours round or are they square? Or right?
I trim them round.
Trim them round.
You can trim them to go any which way.
Right. I was just gonna say when you're trimming them round, make sure you don't get too much at the top and too little at the bottom, because you want that sunlight to be able to come into the center of them. So if they're square, what we usually do is make sure the top is narrower than the bottom is. Of course, going round, that's kind of hard to do unless you end up with an egg shape.
I just
but
do it by eye.
You might take off a little more off the sides when you take some off the top.
Right.
Yeah, if you take to actually just make it all say 6 inches smaller all the way around and see if that doesn't let some light in and encourage some growth from the inside.
Well, they're 15 years old roughly.
Yeah, they're getting there to their, probably thinking about replacing them.
All righty, thank you.
You're welcome.
Thank you very much, WOCA, for the programming. And have a good day, everybody.
Thanks.
Thank you, Sonny.
Yeah.
Carolyn, we are getting close to the end, and if you would allow me to, I have a gift certificate to give away.
I will allow you to, because we keep missing on that.
It's a gift certificate from Bob Wines, and by the way, you can get trees over there.
There you go.
Talk about Arbor Day coming up. This is a $20 gift certificate, and I will make sure you get it if you answer my trivia question of the morning. Are you ready?
There you go.
Here it is. There is a poem. It's titled Trees. It is written by Joyce Kilmer. The question is, what is the first line of that poem? It's a very famous poem. Do you know it? No, without saying it? No? It's a very famous poem.
Probably if I heard it, I would go,
it's called Trees, and a lot of people quote the first line.
So I probably do know.
So the first line
is
popular. I don't know how many. I don't even know that I've ever seen the whole poem, as a matter of fact, but the first line gets quoted a lot. So the poem is called Trees. The poet is Joyce Kilmer, and what I'm asking for is the first line of the poem, and if you tell me, you'll get a $20 gift certificate to Bob Wine's Camellia Gardens and Nursery. Simple as that.
And you can get a tree of your own.
Get a tree, yeah.
Get a tree.
It's
Earth Day. We got Arbor Day coming up. It's
springtime.
Springtime is here. Good time to plant. Whether or not you want a tree or a shrub, I'm sure he's got some nice perennials there. If you're looking for camellias, I've had people come in, and they're always, and I hope I'm not, I'm sure he's got camellias year-round, but of course the best time to buy them is, when you're seeing them blooming, so you know which one. But people looking for them where I'm at, and I'm going, because they're not blooming, the store's not going to carry them. Because people are not interested in them. The nursery has pruned them back. They're growing them, et cetera.
I have to go to the Cascades and see how mine is doing.
Yeah.
We planted one there a few years ago now, right? All right, we do have a caller. Good morning. Did you want to take a crack at the trivia question?
Good morning, Larry. This is June. I think that I shall never see a sight as lovely as a tree.
Close enough. I think I shall never see a poem lovely as a tree.
Oh, Okay. There yeah. we go. Remember that. Yes. That's yeah. awesome.
Well, you've got, is this June, right?
Yeah, this is June.
June, you got $20 waiting for you for Bob Wines.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Have a wonderful day, both of you.
Thank you.
You too.
That was fun.
You too.
Okay, bye-bye, Caroline. Bye-bye.
Bye.
And just in time, too, because we're
out of time.
We are under the Fox News rule of thumb.
There we go.
Which, get off at the right time.
At the right time, that's it. So what we're going to do is say we enjoy our Black Cow manure and Dynamite fertilizer. Get going and get growing.
There you go. And don't. I know you'll be here before May 10th, but don't forget May 10th. It's the big sale, right?
Yep, May 10th is the big sale for Master Gardeners, so set your calendars.
All right. We'll see you next week.
See you next week, Larry.
Enjoy the beautiful day. We'll take a little break. We'll be right back.
Broadcasting from the Paddock Mall Studios, this is WOCA, Ocala, Gainesville, The Villages, 1370 AM, 96.3 FM, The Source.
Fox News Radio, I'm Lillian Wu. Vice President Joe Biden in Kiev promising 50 million more in aid while firing off a message on the crisis in Ukraine.
Standing alongside Ukraine's prime minister, Vice President Biden's message was directed at the Kremlin.
We call on Russia to stop supporting men hiding behind masks in unmarked uniforms, sowing unrest.
The White House warns, should Russia fail to influence separatist groups to disarm and leave occupied buildings, more sanctions are teed up.
Fox Radio's Jared Halpern. President Obama heads to Oso, Washington today, 1 month after the deadly mudslide there.
At least 41 lives were lost when a massive wall of moving earth consumed 49 homes and other structures.
Fox Radio's Steve Taylor. And police say the victim of a Georgia mall shooting yesterday has died of her injuries. The suspect apparently killed himself. Fox News, we report, you decide.
The world is going crazy. There's the potential zombie getting, the meteorite apocalypse, and dolphins are becoming too smart for their own good. Prepare your getaway car now. Stock up on Napa Synthetic Oil for just $3.49 a quart. $3.49. There's hope for us all. Conquer the job with Napa know-how. At participating Napa Auto Parts stores, sale price does not include applicable state, local taxes, or recycling fees. Offer expires 4/30/14.
And now, another golf confessional brought to you by Golfsmith. Recently, a man told us he'd finally learned to deal with his anthropophobia, an overwhelming fear of other people. How? He went to Golfsmith and got the Nike VRS Covert 2.0 driver with its high-speed cavity-back design. Now he hits the ball so far, he doesn't have to be around anyone on the course. You don't need a psychological disorder to get the Nike VRS Covert 2.0 driver. You just need to go to Golfsmith.
Hi, I'm Leah Caruso with Strive Rehabilitation, inviting you to join me Thursday at 11 a.m. for Health Matters. Ocala Health and Strive have teamed up to bring you the latest information on good health services available to you right here at home. This vital information will help you make informed decisions about your health. So don't forget to join me here at 11 a.m. Thursday. It's news you can use from Ocala Health, Strive, and your friends here at WOCA.
Legally Yours, brought to you by Fuller & Fuller Attorneys at Law. On the air every Wednesday morning at 10:30 a.m. with John Fuller, a board-certified civil trial lawyer for over 25 years. John welcomes your questions, from business to complex family matters to legal disputes. So tune in every Wednesday morning at 10:30 a.m. for Legally Yours with John Fuller, right here on WOCA 1370 a.m. and 96.3 FM, The Source.
Gene Powell Pass Des Moines. Our tractor services include bush hog, disking, front end loader, box blade, and stump grinding. We also have zero turn mowers for the smaller paddocks, aisleways, fence rows, and lawn care. Fence row spraying is also available for weed control. We are licensed and insured. Gene Powell Pass Des Moines, 352-629-2440 or online at PowellGene, G-E-N-E, at yahoo.com. Gene Powell Pass Des Moines.
Habitat for Humanity of Marion County is a ministry dedicated to improving lives by providing affordable and decent housing. Help them help others by visiting the Habitat for Humanity Ocala Restore at 926 Northwest 27th Avenue. To schedule a donation, give us a call at 401-0075 and we'll come pick it up. For more information, visit ocalarestore.org. Habitat for Humanity of Marion County, building homes, building hope, building community.
What you may have missed on the John Tesh Radio Show.
About 40% of the things we buy are impulse purchases. Stores know this, so their goal is to keep us there as long as possible with a complicated layout. The number of people taking Ambien and ending up in hospital emergency departments increased by nearly 220% in the last 5 years, and the majority of those ER visits were by women. The more calories we eat at breakfast, the more total calories we're likely to eat the rest of the day.
Intelligence for your life on the John Tesh Radio Show. Don't miss this stuff.
You've got a garden and we've got a show for you called You've Got a Garden with your host, Master Gardener Carol Ann Baldwin. Carol Ann answers your questions about your flowers, your veggies, your grass, your trees, even questions about your bugs. And she's only on WOCA, so don't miss Carol Ann Baldwin and You've Got a Garden each Tuesday from 9 a.m. to 10 a.m. right here on WOCA The Source.